Hey, brothers. Whoop, I'm not ready. Hey, brothers and sisters. This is Brother Patrick here back in the Philippines. You guys are doing all right. Me, jet lagged out. I had the most awesome dream I ever had from the Lord and have not been able to load it till now because, well, jet lagged. Of course, dealing with all the things going on around here. Trying to get ready for the funeral. My father-in-law. Anyway, let's see if you guys can see this. In this picture, you know, I was just looking at the wall this morning. The ceiling, if you can see. You know, everything's kind of backwards, I think, in the video. Right there, above my finger, even the shadow of my lights is like a fleur-de-lis. You know, this house we weren't in, you know, the Lord showed me the fleur-de-lis stuff 2 or 3 years ago. And he keeps showing me again. And you know, this morning when I woke up, I was looking at the ceiling, and there they are, the shadow, the silhouette of my lights are also fleur-de-lis. So you can see there's a whole bunch of them up on the ceiling above my head. Anyway, brothers and sisters, had the most awesome dream. I had a dream, the whole thing. I got to tell this whole dream, the end result. Well, let me just tell you the whole dream. I guess I'll title it. You'll see in the title what the end result is, of course. Let me see. All right. In my dream, I was in here. I was actually in my room here in the dream. And it was like I was having all these attacks, like, you know, to leave my wife, to go do get drunk, to go do whatever, any kind of sin, you know, go commit adultery, fornication, whatever, any I can't remember what all, but just like a complete attack. And I was like trying to resist, trying to fight it in my dream, and it was just like overwhelming, right? And then, you know, just not all these different kinds of sins. It wasn't just like one kind, any kind of sin, divorce my wife, go do this, go do that, everything. And it was like it was getting tighter and tighter around me, you know, like a circle. And it was like, you know, let me just say this. You guys who have watched my videos, you kind of know what I'm talking about. If you never watched my videos, hey, I'm trying my best to explain all this. It's like a unifying theory, the way the Lord shows me. It's like a unifying theory of all the different things that the Lord has shown me. So it's like this. The duality. You know, you got your duality of, you know, God does things A, then the devil tries to pervert it, right? Then you got your duality of the way God does things. Then you've got the duality, you know, judgment versus grace. Jesus is the Son of God, yet the Son of Man. Then the devil has, and all these different things, all at the same time. So there, you know, you got different things that are actually going on. Does it make the other one untrue? They're not, in other words, they're not mutually exclusive. Things are going on at the same time. It's just so far out there. You know, brothers and sisters, I would never think of any of this stuff myself as the book that the Lord gave me to write. You know, Final Boarding Call, Satan's Plan for the Ages, all that stuff about Satan's plan for the ages is not, all of that the Lord showed me through dreams and visions, and then when I looked it up and searched it, there it was. And you know, the Lord led me on that stuff. I have no concern about that, but I've got some good news in this dream. Let me get to it as I lay this out, because it's all different levels. So anyway, it was like, in one way, it was like if you sin or you know, you don't, you can just keep going around in the desert like the children of Israel. You just keep going around in the desert until you're able to overcome whatever that giant in your life is, right? Whether it's drugs, fornication, watching, you know, kind of goes hand in hand with pornography, masturbation, whatever, addictions that people have, whatever. It's that stumbling block in their life. Some people have lots of stumbling blocks. Some people just have one, and they keep saying cuss words, or, you know, like they're easily offended. And take it, you know, we all have our imperfections, right? As even Paul said after he had been, you know, an apostle for how many years, he called himself, you know, he said he was a chief among sinners. So, I mean, we all sin. Nobody's perfect, but we're always trying to, you know, break out and walk in sanctification and walk in holiness and walk with the Lord. You know, and I've talked to, when I talk to people one-on-one, one of the biggest problems people who are serious about the Lord deal with, they're worried about their, you know, are they good enough to get in heaven and all that. And it's like this. No one will ever be perfect. But when you intentionally go greasy grace and intentionally say, hey, I'm going to go out here and willfully sin and wallow in the mire and enjoy my sin because of the grace of God is more abounding than my sin. God knows the thoughts and intents of your heart. I mean, it's just that, you know, it's just that, you know, it's not all this list of rules and all that as much as it is in the New Testament. It's the spirit of the law. So it's our heart's desire and our focus is unto the Lord. Our desire is to please the Lord. Even as Paul said in one of his letters, you know, the things I don't want to do, that's the things I do. And the things I do want to do, I can't, you know, I don't do. So our thoughts and intents are to serve the Lord and to be perfect and not sin. Because we love the Lord, we want to be obedient to the Lord. But yet we still stumble. And that is part of the human condition. We are living in a fallen world. People have to face that reality. It's not this, you know, the Bible says the letter of the law kills, but the spirit gives life. And that's what it is. People trying to follow the letter of the law, not the spirit of the law, which is to walk in love. I obey the Lord not because I don't want to go to heaven and I want to go to heaven and not hell, but because he first loved me and gave himself for me because I love the Lord and the Lord loves me. Not because I love the Lord. Let me back that up. It's not because I love the Lord. It's because he loved me. It's what he has done. And that's the thing that the Lord gave me this. The Lord gave me an old hymnal song. And I heard the multitude singing it at the rapture, brothers and sisters. We got to give God the glory for what he has done. The Lord is the one who came to earth and died for us. And then the Lord had given me Romans chapter 9. He said, you know, some, you know, vessels are for honor and some for dishonor. So God has chosen us, brothers and sisters, to be part of his church, to be part of his bride. And it is marvelous in our eyes. As the Lord said, you know, the cornerstone that the builders have rejected has become the head of the corner or the capstone. And it is marvelous in our eyes. So what he has done. So anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm getting ahead of the bad part of the dream. Let me give how the dream went. So I saw, you know, like I said, you're talking about going in a circle in the wilderness, but then I saw these bands, brothers and sisters, like an Adam, you know. And the thing, there's just so much things that the Lord dumped on me, brothers and sisters. It's just at all levels. You know, creation. We live in a creation, and the Bible tells us that Satan is a god of this world. He's the prince and power of the air. So we're living in the fallen creation, brothers and sisters. Not the creation as it was in the Garden of Eden. Excuse me. We're living in the fallen creation. Even, you know, God made this, but it's a fallen creation. Okay? So we're limited by this earthen vessel until we're raptured or until we die and leave this body. Like my father-in-law, I mean, the Lord was giving me that revelation about the end times, but also the Lord was giving me this revelation in reference to my father-in-law because he was a Christian. You know, we break free from the bonds of this earth. You know, and Jude, it talks about the angels who kept not their first estate. Now, that word there is not talking about necessarily, it's not talking about their estate of being in heaven. It's talking about their estate of the body that they were in. They left that glorified body. Just like when the two angels appeared at Sodom and Gomorrah, they had come and people thought they were humans. They were not going around, you know, in bright light and white clothes and wings and all this kind of stuff like other angels have appeared in the Bible. They appeared as men, just like on the at the Battle of Jericho. There was, you know, the Lord of Sabaoth. It's a pre-incarnated Christ, a Christophany, a theophany. The Lord appeared, the Lord Jesus Christ appeared before he came to earth through the Virgin Mary. He appeared to, he is the Lord of Sabaoth. He appeared to Joshua just before the Battle of Jericho and said, you know, who are you? Whose side are you on? And he said, and then the Lord of Sabaoth said, you know, said to him, you know, I'm the angel, you know, of the Lord, take off your shoes, you're standing on holy ground. Anyhow, I'm trying to stay on track here. I saw these shells, like shells of an atom, brothers and sisters, like the shells of an atom. You know, in other words, like the Matrix or whatever. Even though this is a creation and God made it, this is the fallen creation. You know, so God's got his creation, and then the devil is copying that too. And, you know, you talk about this sacred geometry and all that stuff, that that these New Age people, I mean, that's the wisdom that Satan, you know, wants to give to mankind, all this sacred geometry and all this kind of stuff, which is really part of God's creation, but it's the fallen creation. And it's the wisdom that actually is useless. The wisdom of the creation is, You know, you can't go make your own creation. Only God made a creation. Satan can't make a creation. It's useless to know. If you knew all the secrets of, you know, how God spoke into existence the planets, you know, that's what Satan wants. He wants to be like God. He wants to do that. The New Age movement tells people, you know, the Christ consciousness. They say this stuff, you know, you are God. What Satan told Eve in the garden and what Mormonism tells their followers, you can become a God. The New Age lie is the Christ consciousness. You are God. That's what they all go look at the teachings of the New Age movement. And any all religions on earth, basically, except for biblical Christianity, tells you that you can become perfected through works and all this kind of stuff. That's what's unique about the gospel. You are saved by grace through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. All these other religions are saying that you can obtain godhood and perfection, you know, by going through these levels, either through the deeds that you do, the tasks that you do, or through, you know, some with a lot of this New Age stuff. It's this ritualistic stuff going all the way back to the Tower of Babel, through the mystery religions, as the Lord's been having me look at today. And I guess the second book is going to be along that topic. As I mentioned before, we're mainly looking at coming out of Egypt from Akhenaten. And the Lord has had me studying the Rosicrucians right now. The Rosicrucians got their wisdom from Akhenaten, as the Lord told me to study Akhenaten. Not this false person, people on YouTube claiming to be half fallen angel and half man who claims that, you know, Obama looks like Akhenaten. And no, the mystery is not who looks like Akhenaten. The mystery is the religion of the Antichrist and the false prophet is coming through. You know, there's a type in Akhenaten. There's a type in Akhenaten. Just like Hitler is a type of the Antichrist, Akhenaten was a type of the Antichrist. Pharaoh that withstood Moses is a type of Antichrist. Napoleon is a type of Antichrist. And so, anyway, brothers and sisters, as I've been doing videos of road signs to the rapture, as the Lord has had me, I haven't done one in a while. You know, the Lord had given me those road signs to the rapture. I've also been doing roadsides to the Antichrist. I haven't called it that. I didn't even realize that till the Lord told me yesterday. The videos I've made in Satan's Plan for the Ages is really road signs to the rise of the Antichrist. Road signs to the rise of the Antichrist. And I'm getting there. But when I was looking at those shells, brothers and sisters, like an atom that were around me, you know, like I say, this is at all different levels. This is not just... But for me, you know, the Lord was showing me that, okay, this is the devil's plan to hold you in, to box you in, to get you to walk around that desert, to keep you from getting to the Lord and doing God's will. He's got you boxed in. But it's also the way that the fallen world operates. You know, we have sickness, disease, people die, like my father-in-law. All these things are there at every level, brothers and sisters, of this fallen creation. From the atom to the cosmos to your personal walk and trying to get to the Lord and get past Satan's schemes and plans and plots, it's all the same. I mean, it's you know, it's all the same, but it's just, it can be described the same way, but at different levels. It all operates basically on the same pattern. These are patterns, brothers and sisters, just like pattern of types and shadows and patterns. Pharaoh, Akhenaten, Hitler, the mystery religions of ancient Egypt, of Babylon, Ishtar, to worshiping the Virgin Mary, to that's a different whole different line I'm following. I skipped off of one to the other. The, you know, this theme of the godmother, the fertility godmother and child goes all the way back to Tammuz, to Babylon. Then you follow this other thread I'm following from ancient Babylon to the Egyptians, and I'm not getting them all, to the Knights Templar, to the Rosicrucians, to modern day Freemasonry. All of these are road signs, types, and shadows and forms of Satan's hand in this fallen world to bring about the capstone of the kingdom of Satan, as Jesus is the capstone of his story, history of God's plan for the ages. Satan's plan for the ages is capstone with the Antichrist, his perversion of God's perfect plan. So as I was looking at those shells, brothers and sisters, around me like an atom. And it was infinite number of shells. I mean, they were just like a steel band that I couldn't break free from. That was on and on and on and on. And like I was pulled back where I could see these bands and bands and bands. And on those bands was like electrons, brothers and sisters. Like an atom. But when the Lord let me see that each electron was like a fleur-de-lis, brothers and sisters, like a fleur-de-lis, but they were swirled. Like the Stargate thing, the vision that the Lord gave me, the image, you know, the mark of the beast in I assume maybe it's not the literal mark of the beast, but a metaphoric way, a spiritual way of seeing the mark of the beast is this Stargate, this, you know, the spiral swirl. I saw, you know, infinite number of spiral swirls on each of those bands, but the spiral swirl was actually a fleur-de-lis, you know, but it was swirled. And then I even saw that it even looked like the Nazi symbol, even though the Nazi symbol has four pieces on it, but it's still that kind of a same thing, that symbol of the Nazi cross has got that swirl to it, brothers and sisters. And Hitler, of course, as I mentioned already, is a great type of the Antichrist, even as he said he would have a 1,000-year reign. You know, the kingdom of Germany would be a 1,000-year reign. He tattooed the Jews and the other people he put in the concentration camps that he didn't like, anyone that opposed him. Like Dietrich Bonhoeffer, famous guy, Christian who gave up his life and wrote a famous book. While, you know, and he died in a concentration camp just near the end of the war. He was killed. Anyway, so you have all of these types and patterns, brothers and sisters, at every level. All the stuff I've tried to tell you guys about, this is building on that. This is really the capstone. I can't even describe all these things in words when I'm trying to tell you. I believe that's what my calling from God is on YouTube, besides giving people words and all that kind of stuff, is taking big, giant things from God, like this, you know, giant stuff, and then being able to explain it in terms that anyone can understand. And I believe that's my gifting and calling from God on YouTube ultimately, is to break these things down to where everyone can understand them. And that's just the way the Lord has used me. Just like being in the Philippines, where the average person I deal with maybe went to the fifth grade. I have to break down even for the people to understand the gospel, you know, and then through a translator and all that. It's so that, you know, for all the years, the 7 years I've been in the Philippines, I've learned, and I worked with Filipinos in the States before that, so more than 10, 11 years. I learned to break those things down, you know, to the simplest terms. And I didn't know until, you know, the last few years that God would prepared me through that process to be able to break these things down. So there's lots of this thing that I'm trying to get my mind around. That's why I haven't made the video either, because of jet lag and trying to get my mind around it. As the Lord has had me, you know, looking at this, the thread, all of these threads I'm talking about. So right now the Lord has me following the Rosicrucian, and these patterns lead to the Antichrist. And I've been following this trail that the Lord has given me. And because the Lord wants this information out there, I always have to give that disclaimer. Yes, of course we're looking for the Lord. This video is not for, if you're a Christian and you're walking with the Lord, and, you know, it's for those who are not, for those who are lost, who might see this video after the rapture. It's for those who are lukewarm, who may be left behind, who would see this video. So, brothers and sisters, for you Christians who are looking about the rapture, this is for you also, and let me get to that. So the devil had all these bands around me and everything, and I was like, boom, I got to break out. And it was like I was in here, in the bed, in the dream. It's like, it was like it was real. I got up. I left the room, brothers and sisters, went into the kitchen, is right outside this door. And it was dark in there, just like it really was. It was nighttime. And standing over at the sink of the kitchen was a man wearing a crown. He was wearing a red, like a dress suit jacket, and he was wearing black pants, like a suit, you know, sports jacket, whatever. And he had on a crown, a great big old crown. And they look a little bit like one of my brother-in-laws, because they were actually staying here, you know, because we're dealing with the death of my father-in-law. And I thought it was him for a second, and I even called his name. And then I heard this laugh like Bowser from Donkey Kong, brothers and sisters. I'm laughing now. But in my dream, I was actually terrified when I heard that ha, ha, ha laugh like that. It was not funny at all in my dream. I was scared to death. I was terrified, and my bones shook for a few seconds when I started walking toward them. But let me tell you what happened, brothers and sisters. Because I always have people asking me, because they watch all these wacky videos on YouTube, and they get nervous about the tribulation is so close, and we haven't been raptured yet, and they'll ask me, people ask me almost daily, somebody who I talk to on YouTube will ask me, are we really going to be raptured? It's probably one of the most common questions I get. Let me tell you what happened. I kept walking toward this individual. This was the Antichrist. It was Satan. I knew it was Satan, but I also knew it was Antichrist. He was wearing that big old crown. And as I was, and as a big old crowd, he had it sit kind of cocked on his head too, like he's so tough and cool. And when I got closer to him, he did that laugh and scared me to death. But just before I got close enough that the light would shine on his face, listen to me, before the light showed on his face, before his face was revealed to me, all of a sudden I heard a massive choir, brothers and sisters, the multitude of millions of people singing this song. They were singing this song right here. And I've got the lyrics in front of me. To God be the glory, great things he has done. So loved he the world that he gave us his son, who yielded his life an atonement for sin and opened the life gate. And that word was amplified, life gate, that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. That was emphasized to me. Let the earth hear his voice. When the Lord shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air. I was caught up, brothers and sisters, and during this song I was caught up, and I couldn't see all the people, but they were all, and we were singing this song at the rapture. When we met the Lord in the air, everyone was singing this song. And I hope that it's literally true, that we will literally be singing this song. And I never knew all the stanzas of this song. I only really knew the chorus before. Let me read it to you. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. That's another part that was emphasized. Everyone at the rapture was singing that part, was amplified. Give him the glory. And that's what I was telling you in the beginning of this video. I'm saved, and I mentioned about loving the Lord. I'm obeying the Lord because I love him. No, it's because he loved me. Give him the glory. Great things he hath done. And that's the part that was just ringing in my ears as the people really shouted that part. Give him the glory. Great thing he has done. This song, as the Lord showed me in my dream, is really about the rapture. I never knew all the choruses, the lyrics to it, the stanzas. Listen, let me keep reading. I'm going to read this. A perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes, that moment from Jesus a pardon received. Then it goes back to praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. You know, the thing about my father-in-law, this part, you know, the Lord showed me for my father-in-law. My father-in-law was a younger guy. He was a bad dude. He was even on drugs for a while and all this stuff way back, maybe 30 years ago. And maybe 25 years ago or so, he got saved, 20 years ago. And he had changed completely. You know, he was really a bad boy before. And he, you know, and that part was like emphasized, you know, the vilest offender who truly believes. He was a vile person before. And then he was changed by the grace of God, by the Spirit of God, by the Word of God. He was transformed and changed to a new creature in Christ. And that part was emphasized in my spirit for him, you know, for him as an example, because everybody knows that my father-in-law, you know, the people that know him, why he was so bad before, you know. But then almost all of my wife's relatives are never been as bad as him, but none of them are Christians. I mean, you know, we all sin. I mean, they weren't like on drugs and stuff like he was, and do it and getting violent and stuff like that like he did until about 20 years ago when he became a Christian. So all of their, you know, my wife's relatives are like, hey, Jinky was such a bad guy, you know, how in the world could he go to heaven? And that's the message from the Lord. Great, give him the glory, the great things that God has done. You know, and the message from the Lord for Christians, when a Christian dies, like myself and my wife and her immediate family, they're all Christians. The message is praise the Lord. You know, it's a rejoice. Let the people rejoice, because when someone dies and goes to heaven, Paul said to live is Christ, to die is gain. So when a Christian dies, we should praise the Lord. And, you know, this is what I'm going to preach the night before the funeral. I'm going to be going there Friday night. I'll be preaching. It's about 4 hours from here. I'll be preaching at the funeral home the night before. And then they have the interment ceremony. I'll be preaching there. I'll be talking to a couple hundred people at least because my father-in-law was a well-known person and has lots of relatives and lots of friends. And I don't think any of them are Christians at all, except for the people from the church, right? Of course, those the people, they'll be singing and stuff at the funeral for, you know, helping me out to evangelize them and, you know, do the work of the Lord. So I ask you guys to pray about that. But let's keep going. Let me keep reading the text here from the song, the lyrics. A perfect redemption, a purchase of blood to every believer, the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Great things he has taught us, great things he has done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus his Son. But pure and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport. But the word from the original song is a rapture. I'm going to put a link here of a version of the song. And the word they use is rapture. Our wonder, our rapture, not transport. Transport in a way means the same thing. Our transport, when Jesus we see. And I don't know what the original one is. Transport, the other one it says rapture. But when Jesus we see. And it's talking about the rapture. When we are there with the Lord. I never knew that was in the song. I know I know the chorus and that's it. This song is awesome song. And it's from the Lord. And as I said, brothers and sisters, it was so awesome that the multitudes were singing this song. Let me go back and say this, because I want to explain this. So in other words, before the Antichrist was revealed, we were raptured. Okay? If you read 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and keep reading down through there, it talks about the restrainer and all that being removed. That is the Holy Spirit through the church. There's no angel that's restraining the force of evil. Angels can restrain Satan. Angels can restrain people and all that, but angels cannot restrain a force. Only the Holy Spirit of God can restrain a force of evil to overtake this earth during the tribulation period. That is the Holy Spirit operating where? The Holy Spirit operates through his people, through the church. Okay? So the Antichrist was almost revealed. The road signs were going there. So all the things we've been seeing, brothers and sisters, people are getting nervous because it's like standing on the edge of a cliff. But we got a little bit farther to walk in on that cliff of judgment, of a persecution of Christians, and you know, good being called evil and evil being called good. All those things are still pressing forward. But the thing that I want, let me add this about the dream because it's emphasized to me about my father-in-law, but this is for all Christians. When that's, you know, through the redemption of Christ, brothers and sisters, we are free from the law of sin and death. Even though Satan tried to put all these bounds, I'm not even talking about the rapture. So, you know, clear your mind on that. Let's not talk about when you die or the rapture. Let's clear your mind on that. Erase that from your mind for a second. It's a whole nother message from the same dream. When we are saved, brothers and sisters, we are no longer bound by the law of sin and death. When, you know, we can get above. We can walk on water. We can walk on top of those steel bands of the limitations of this world, of this flesh, of death, hell, and the grave. The world, the flesh, and the devil. We have authority over all that in Christ. We can walk across the top of that in this life, brothers and sisters. Now, I've been talking in the beginning, you know, and saying, you know, of course, we all sin and all that. That's true. But, you know, we got to have balance, okay? And it's not an excuse to justify sin. And that's the problem with lots of people. They love to hear that. They want to tickle their ears. I have more, you know, people that like to watch my videos when I'm going to throw out, when they think I'm talking a greasy grace. I'm not saying that. I'm saying it's the attitude of your heart. Your desire is to please the Lord and do his will. But you're still overcoming the sin in your life. We all sin every day. We all stumble. We're in the flesh. We're in this body. But we have authority over those things, brothers and sisters. We can overcome all things. As an example, when someone gets saved, the kingdom of heaven has come near. The laws of this world have been broken when someone gets saved. Because the Bible says, God said to Adam and Eve, when you eat the fruit, you're going to die. If you eat this fruit, he told Adam and Eve, you'll die if you eat this fruit. And then we can overcome death through salvation, through the, you know, as we will be resurrected in Christ by the Spirit of God. So the same thing is true for sickness and disease. There are you know, we call them miracles. When a miracle, someone is healed, an answered prayer. This is bypassing, overriding the kingdom of darkness, overriding the limitations of our flesh. So, brothers and sisters, there is a way above and beyond this fallen creation, and it's by faith. I'm not talking about just going in. Now, see, that's where you're... Now, my father-in-law was a Baptist. Now, you know, my uncle had a heart attack, too, the same day, the day before. Or really, they had him at the same time, because my father-in-law waited 2 or 3 days before he went to the hospital. My uncle did, too. But my uncle's still alive, and he's a Baptist preacher. And, you know, my father-in-law is a Baptist also. And then they'll stop with that. What I've been saying up till now, they stop there. But you can go beyond that, brothers and sisters. As, you know, I talk about being baptized Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, and the gifts of the Spirit. These gifts of the Spirit, as an example, is a physical manifestation of overriding this whole system that I saw in my vision of the steel bands of the enemy's plans to trap you, to block you, to kill, steal, and destroy you. And this fallen world, all those things. And then our own flesh, our own sin nature, all those things can be overridden by the power of the Holy Spirit, by the Word of God. And as I said, we call that a miracle. So we can strive to overcome this world. We are not limited by this world. As an example, if you're born again, you've already seen it and proven that you've been able to overcome going to hell by the power of the Most High God. Same thing is true with healings, speaking in tongues, as I mentioned, words of wisdom, words of knowledge, prophecy, discernment of spirits, all those gifts of the Spirit, 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Even the fruit of the Spirit, Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23. The fruit of the Spirit is not, that's what I'm saying. That's a whole nother sermon. I better stop this. I just want to say this because I just mentioned it. Fruit of the Spirit. There's lots of people that say, well, you know, I'm a patient person, blah, blah, blah. That's not the fruit of the Spirit. That's you. You know, you have a character or a nature. Your character is to be a patient person. Some other person's character, like myself, I have a limit of patience in my natural character. But under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, when I'm doing the Lord's work and ministering for Him, and as the Lord would lead me, like, you know, that's the fruit of the Spirit. When the Spirit comes on you to love those who you don't love, to help those who you don't want to help, you know, to be patient with those people that are jerks. Not because you just say, hey, I want to do it because that's the right thing to do, because the Bible says turn the other cheek, I'm going to turn the other cheek. Fruit of the Spirit is when, by the power of the Holy Spirit, that's beyond your natural ability. That's the problem with all these old denominational people and people that are not spiritually minded, they're so carnal minded. They're just doing it in their flesh. And, you know, it can even become a source of pride and self-righteousness. You know, that's the biggest thing I observed. People have asked me, I don't want to call it. I can't call people's names. There's a truck driver on YouTube, but it's not Andy Firecharger, who is just, who's a very self-righteous person. He's like that, all puffed up in his flesh. I don't watch his videos. I've seen bits and snip bits, and lots of people, several people have asked me, about this guy full of self-righteousness and vinegar. And it's all in the flesh. Brothers and sisters, it's only by the Spirit. In my flesh, I'm just the same as any of you guys, anybody else in my flesh. And there are a few people on YouTube who try to get me in the flesh. But by the grace of God, brothers and sisters, because for whatever reason of His own, God chose me to be a preacher, and God chose me to make videos, and God chose me to do the orphanage and all that stuff. He predestined me for it. And I'm able to do it by the power of His might. So that's why, just like the song says, you know, I give Him the glory for great things He has done. I haven't done anything on my own. I don't have the desire, the temperament, or the patience, or the wisdom to do the orphanage and all that. I could probably have tried to do somewhat, you know, and there's tons of, like the Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses, and they're doing all this kind of stuff in their flesh, so it can be done. But I don't have the character to do that. You know, and so that, you know, it's the fruit of the Spirit. It's not my fruit, it's not my abilities, but His. Same thing with you, brothers and sisters. The thing about it is, the more, just like, you know, God, the Lord Jesus told Paul, you know, my grace is made perfect in your weakness. So the bigger of a moron you are, the bigger of a clown you are, the bigger of issues that you have, the more power of God, the more grace of God required, the more that God can get to glory. Because there are lots of people, like maybe I don't know, Joel Osteen, you know, he's keeps grinning and all that. People like that, that's charismatic. Of course, I wouldn't describe him as so charismatic, but you know what I mean. There are people who have natural ability to speak and be charismatic and all that kind of stuff, and they naturally draw people. That's in their flesh. It's not a fruit of the Spirit. You know, it's in their flesh, not by the Spirit. Anyway, brothers and sisters, the point is, as I've made many points in this video, and I'm going to title this about a dream of the church's rapture before the Antichrist is revealed, and those running to and fro people who, I'm genuinely worried that they will not be raptured. They're the very ones. They'll always say something like, which there's not that many, but there'll always be one that makes a comment. Just tell me the dream. Just tell me what your dream was. Don't tell me anything else. No. Lord knows they don't want to hear any Bible verses. Lord knows they don't want to get any teaching. Lord knows they don't want to grow and be discipled. As I said, I'm very worried about their salvation, if they're saved at all, and I'm very worried about whether if they are they're going in the rapture or not because of their immaturity, selfish, shallow-minded mentality. Brothers and sisters, I ask you to pray for all of those who are just, you know, they're at the edge of the water, but they're about to miss the boat. And it's a shame to go so far and miss the boat. You know, it's like a waste. I mean, it'd been better to go out and party and live a wild life and just be a fool in the world and then miss the rapture and get saved and then, you know, during the tribulation and go as a tribulation saint than to live trying to follow the law and self-righteousness or living in a greasy gracing status that you can live like hell and go to heaven and then miss the boat just barely, you know, that would be the worst. It's better to go out, you know, miss it by a long shot than, you know, almost only counts, what do they say? Almost only counts in, what is it, horseshoes and something. You don't want to be an almost. And I guess I need to know that saying before I made the videos, but I wasn't planning on saying, you know, almost only counts in horseshoes. And anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you guys. I think it's a great dream and, a great teaching from the Lord. I thank the Lord for it. And as I begin to continue to study about the Rosicrucians and all that stuff, I've got lots more information for you guys. The Lord has been leading me on this stuff. And it's just incredible, brothers and sisters. It is incredible. I haven't even talked about the stuff that the Lord showed me. It's just wild. I think it's raining hard outside. Anyway, God bless you guys. Love you guys. I thank you for all your prayers for the funeral and stuff. Pray for the salvation of those people. You know, at least they'll hear the truth. You know, I don't know how many of them will get saved because we all have free will. But I pray that they'll have ears to hear. You know, receive the truth in their heart and then have that willful consciousness to accept or reject. That's the prayer for me, that, you know, nothing will hinder them from having a fair shot at hearing the gospel clearly in their mind and in their heart and reject it and make an informed decision for or against the Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you guys.